Good evening and welcome to this 42nd episode of the Plastic Scale Modeling Hour Talk Radio for Scale Modelers. It is October 31st, 2012. Happy Halloween!
Chippy must have let one of the tricksters into the studio when I wasn't looking and they snuck that into the intro. The tree is being with you for another great episode of the Plastic Scale Modeling Hour. If you hear the doorbell ring, don't worry, I won't be getting up to answer it. It's my treat, or trick as they say, for the little monsters. Well, joining me for this episode of the Plastic Scale Modeling Hour is our good friend Jason Gares from Video Workbench. And we've got, well, I called on Jason to talk about the topic of fillers. So let's talk a little bit about fillers. First of all, let's define what a filler is used for.
Well, basically a filler, just as much as the word is and can describe onto itself, is that you have a gap, let's say, in a model that you're working on, and you need to fill that gap. And if you don't fill that gap, pretty much it's going to be an eyesore for the rest of the time that you are looking at that model or somebody else is looking at that model.
We try to minimize such things from happening, and that's where test fitting comes in and, you know, working the plastic to get the best fit with the tightest tolerances. But, you know, there are some kits out there where you might end up just sanding a whole wing away and it's still not fit.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy. And then when you get into that kind of situation, we've all been there. You want to pull your hair out. You want to pull your hair out, and sometimes you want to throw that thing against the wall, and you're like, no, I spent too much money on this, so what is my solution? And the solution is a filler. And there are many different types of fillers out there, many different types of materials. And some materials work better than others with certain types of fillers. So it's a lot of trial and error. That's pretty much how I learned, trial and error or by suggestion.
Well, let's just talk about some of the filler products that are commonly seen out there in the hobby, and we'll kind of outline some of their attributes and some of their they're not so good properties when it comes to working with them.
Right.
Now, for me, I'm a styrene guy.
Okay.
I like to use stretch sprue and solvent to weld everything together. I was told there's no replacement for metal like metal, and there's no replacement for plastic like using plastic. If you use styrene and a good solvent, you can fill a gap, and it'll be strong. And it is made of all the same material. So when it's exposed to heat, when you're traveling in your car to go to a contest, or it's the dead of winter and you put it in the trunk and it's cold, the plastic will expand and contract at the same rate. Now, when you start to use dissimilar materials, such as other filler media, you're dealing with like trying to put a wood plug into a metal boat, so to speak.
Right. I agree.
You have to, you know, some people like the idea of making it quicker. For me, I mean, I used to use filler all the time. I mean, I would go through literally tubes of Squadron Green Putty. While I'm talking, I have the tube in my hand. I mean, that familiar toluene smell. It was a great product, but as technologies, and we look a lot towards the automotive industry today for some of the fillers we use. But what's your primary filler that you like using?
Yeah, believe it or not, I love using 5-minute epoxy. And the epoxy that I use is actually a Gorilla brand 5-minute epoxy. And I usually try to use that on everything that I can, plastic models, resin kits, mainly on resin kits because it bonds so well with resin. Kind of in the area where you're going to fill that gap, you take some sandpaper and rough it up just a little bit and mix the 5-minute epoxy and kind of drip it in there. Now, if the gap is too big, another thing that I like to do is backfill. I'll use some newspaper or use some type of paper towel and just kind of cram that in there a little bit so that I'm not using as much 5-minute epoxy. And put the 5-minute epoxy on, and I'm kind of generous with it because I know that I'm going to sand it down. And when I sand it down, I wet sand, so then I get a nice smooth finish.
And the other thing wet sanding offers is that it does not, it prevents the sanding residue from loading up whatever you're sanding with, so that you can easily wipe it or wash it away.
Correct. And I deal with a lot of resin kits. As a matter of fact, I'm working on 3 masterpiece model time machines, and all those are completely resin, except for the electronics. I have 2 boards that I have to, that I've welded together, and or soldered together, excuse me. And there's a motor because there's a spinning disc and whatnot, but the 95% of the model is resin, so I use a Gorilla 5-minute epoxy in order to fill the gaps.
And I've used epoxy. I've used it on some vinyl. I've done it, like you said, on resin kits. It works very well. You just have to have your test fitting done.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to work within the time frame, because once it gets close to that magic minute, it starts to set, and then your working time is literally gone.
Right.
Another thing that comes to mind, it has a limited working time, is using CA or super glues.
Yeah.
You can use slow curing. You can use, you know, thin, there's thick, there's medium.
Right.
There's a gel now that they have out. There's a lot of different formulations. But one of the drawbacks with using, and it depends on the epoxy material, the 2-minute epoxy that you're, 5-minute epoxy, and the super glue that you're using. Well, actually, super glue, it doesn't matter. But the longer it cures, the harder it gets.
Yes.
So this is where that dissimilar materials come into play. Is, I mean, I used to use super glue a lot.
Right.
Glue something up, and then I get distracted, have to leave it. When I come back, whether it be an hour or 2 days later, it's like iron.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to sand and file something like cured resin and CA, I ended up finding myself damaging the styrene because it takes so much more effort to shape the medium, like super glues and epoxies, than it does the plastic.
Right. And you're using a lot more force if you've let it set too long. You know, you learn that there's a kind of like sweet time, so to speak, that, you know, you learn after a while, to where, you know, you don't jump on it right away to start sanding it, but you don't let it go far too long before it really starts to set. There are different grades of epoxy that you can use for different types of materials that you're going to glue together, so you may want to look at that. There's also different curing times. You have 1 minute, that's the lowest I've seen. The regular 5 minute, and I've seen it up to a 10-minute cure time. So you can have 10 minutes worth of, after you mix it together, you can work with it. So that's really nice. And then you can decide how you want to mix it. You want to mix it on a piece of cardboard, like I do, with a toothpick, and or anything else larger or smaller, depending upon your need for your model.
Now, the one attribute that using epoxy or super glues or CA is that it is widely available.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can run down to your local hardware store and pick up epoxies and different types of super glues.
Yeah.
Not limited to just retail shopping at a hobby store to get it.
Right.
So if you're working on a Sunday afternoon and you find out, oh, my tube's dried up, my bottle's dried up, I want to get this kit done, you can run down to the local hardware store and most department stores and find it.
Right. And another good thing about that too, besides the availability, is the price point. It's not really expensive, but just like anything worthwhile or worth its weight in gold, I believe you should pay for a little bit. I've dealt with many different brands and many different types of epoxy, and the one that's really widely available is by 3M. That one's okay. It's not the best. If you don't have a lot of money or don't want to spend a lot of money, I would suggest a 3M. But the Gorilla brand, which I just started using a year ago, I am very, very impressed with. You can get it at any local hardware store. You can get it at any department store. And it mixes very well, and it gets hard, very, very hard within a very short amount of time after you're done mixing it. So the 3M, the quality isn't as good as the Gorilla, but the price point is there. But I'd suggest the Gorilla.
Yeah, and another place that you can look also for you guys that are into cars and such, check your automotive supply houses. Loctite makes a whole line of different adhesives, and I do believe they have an epoxy line as well as a line of CAs.
Another good place you could go is, it's on the internet, catalog.
Micromark?
Micromark, yes, Micromark. Oh, boy, do they have the tools. You go crazy with all the tools that they have, and you'll never be able to buy all of them either, but they also carry epoxy too. So, there's another way of getting it.
We mentioned a few minutes ago the old Squadron Green putty.
Yeah.
And they also make a white putty. Now, the attributes with putties is that something you really want to look for. If you're doing a light colored scheme, say a white airliner or something,
mm-hmm.
trying to paint over green putty is very difficult. You have to primer the whole thing to even out your coloration and tones.
Right.
So, and we mentioned, the source for epoxies and CAs is the automotive supply house as well. Mentioning that, and also 3M, my favorite putty of all putties is actually 3M's, and I'm still using a tube of Acro Blue glazing putty.
Okay.
They do have Acro White. I know the Acro Blue apparently has been discontinued. They have different colors. But a glazing putty is actually, the difference between a filler putty and a glazing putty is the consistency of the grains.
Okay.
And when you're doing modeling, one of the things you want is you want it to be easy to work with. You want it to be quick drying, and you want it to be easily sandable. Now, there's some putties out there that guys are using where, they'll load up their sandpaper or their sanding sticks, and then they're complaining that it takes so much work. And then when they get done, the other attribute that we look for is a nice, clean, very hard-to-see feathered edge.
Right.
You just want it to blend right into the surface of the plastic so you don't have that little step that you have to worry about.
I remember when I first started modeling, of course, the tube of filler that I would pick up would be the tester's tube of modeling putty. And it's good for a beginner, yes. I think I learned, and I don't know if other people have learned very quickly that, and I'm not bashing the product here, this is from my own perspective, it likes to flake. You put it in, you let it set, and, when you're sanding it, it has this quality where it likes to flake or it likes to ball up or bunch up, and the natural progression from the tester's filler or putty would be going to the Squadron Green or West putty. That's a little bit more, it's got more substance to it, and it doesn't flake like the tester's does. So I would bypass, if somebody's stuck in the hobby and they're like, oh no, I have to fill this gap in, I would bypass the tester's and I would go straight for the Squadron putty. Even even though it's, you know, we're talking that's kind of like the old timer's way, you could say, it's still a good putty to use for somebody who's beginning or even intermediate or somebody coming back into the hobby. It's, you know, everybody has their own kind of comfort food that they like to eat. Well, comfort putty, in my outlook on things, would be the green or the white squadron putty.
You know, one of the things that separates a novice modeler from an experienced or master modeler, besides their skills, is also what they're using. As far as we're talking today, talking about fillers, you mentioned if you start out, you'll start out with a tester's putty. And then progression is for most modelers, they'll eventually get to squadron putty. And as I made the jump to glazing putty, and there's other brands out there, as again, the putties that we use or we like to use come from the auto restoration and auto body repair industry, because these guys demand perfection. And they're using these same products, not only on metal, but on cars that have plastic components, fiberglass components. So they're looking for the similar attributes that we are dealing with styrene. Somebody who's been on the show and is a reviewer for Fine Skeel, his secret is he likes to use window glazing.
Mm-hmm.
He says it's very easy to use. You can go down and buy a can. You know, they come in small pint cans, up to quart cans, up to great big gallon cans if you so need that much glazing. But he says it works very well. It just, you can fill in, give it a wipe. It doesn't change shape, you know, too much. It holds paint and it looks good long enough to get the reviews done.
That almost sounds like it's what Al Jones would do.
You know, you just hit the nail on the head.
Yeah, back in the day when I was part of the Bong Chapter group, I would see Al all the time. And as a matter of fact, when I was doing the competitions, I would see Al almost at every competition I would be at. And he would do Hobby Town shows, and of course he would do the one in Madison, the Mad City Modelers, and so I would see him around a lot, and I got to know Al through the circuit and going to the Bonk Chapter. And he is a treasure trove of knowledge, and that's a guy that I would suggest anybody listen to, because he's got a lot of knowledge, and he knows what he's talking about, and never blow the guy off. The guy is great, and he loves to talk, and he loves to give you information. So, you know,
Al's one of those guys who has paid it forward to modelers throughout the, well, now I probably would say probably around the world, because a lot of people that he knew and when they were younger are now world travelers. But a lot of the things that I know about scale modeling, I can attribute to learning them from Al. And, of course, as modelers, there's some things that I've taught him over the years as well.
Right.
You just take something and it says, well, that works, but there's got to be a better way.
Right.
You know, so, but I have in my stash of supplies, I have some of the very same window glazing compound that he uses. I went out and bought some, and I have actually used it, and I will admit it does work well. I'm not saying it's the best, but it
right.
does work well.
I think the whole, just like anything else, the whole idea of putties and what's available and what you use is a matter of preference, and that's why there's so many out there to choose from. It has to deal with preference, how you like how it works with a particular material, and you know, that's pretty much it. There's no end-all, be-all type of filler for any type of particular material. It's all through time and patience and figuring out what works best for you.
And let's just talk a minute here about some tricks to make the putties that we are using work better. Now, we've all know, and I'm probably guilty of it, about washing our model before painting. And I know there's some of us who don't do it. And it comes back to bite us occasionally because there'll be a little bit of oil residue and that's where the paint will flake off.
Yep.
But the same things that hold true with painting also hold true with applying putties. You need to have a good, clean, viable surface. So you want to make sure it's clean. You also don't want to have any paint residue. If you've gone in and painted something and then found out, oh, look at that. The paint really made that really stick out. There's that flaw that I thought the paint would hide. Paint doesn't hide flaws. It accentuates them.
Right.
So some people will just go in there and start putting some filler in there and then sand it real quick and then, you know, paint over it. But you'll find out over time that that will be where the putty will fail or the filler will fail. Take the time, just like a dentist has to do when they're repairing a filling, they go in, take the old material out, get in there, get to the clean ends, and then start from scratch.
I'm very, very religious and agree with you with cleaning your kit before you put anything on it. It's very, very important. And as a matter of fact, one of my future quick tips that I'm going to be putting up on my YouTube channel is going to be about cleaning. And I'm actually cleaning the finishing parts of the model that I mentioned before. You know, I'm showing people this is how I clean. I know some people are going to say, what are you doing? You're showing me how to clean here? Well, yes, I am, because there's different ways that you can go about cleaning your parts, and you can clean your parts with different things besides water and soap, like I do. Actually, solvents that you can use to almost strip off any type of release agent off of the parts. But then, when you do that, the reason why I don't use anything like that is because you can actually kind of ruin your parts that way. So, wash your parts with soap and water. I highly, highly suggest that. I can't stress that enough. Before you do anything with your kit.
So yeah, it's very important that you again clean your model before applying any filler putties to the areas. Take your compressor, your airbrush. If you've been sanding and you found out there's some plastic residue in there, blow it out with your airbrush. You know, you don't have to have any paint, just air. That helps you clean out those cracks and crevices. Run a Q-tip in there with some solvent. I like to use isopropyl alcohol.
Yeah.
It does a good job of busting up any finger oils and any of the release agents. And then you can work in small areas that way. What do you use to apply your fillers? Well, for some people, they just basically take and lick their finger, apply it to their finger, and then wipe it on. That may work with the window glazing compound fairly well, but you know, when you're starting to use something like CA, super glues, and epoxies, that's really not the thing you want to do. One, it's a mess. And secondly, you're inflicting, you know, the oils from your hands and other foreign matter into the putty that you're trying to apply to the model.
Well, you know, I'm looking for this interview. I had brought out a bunch of fillers that I use, and I have them here on my table here at the studio on my workbench. And I'm looking at a very, very good product right now. It's Avey's Epoxy Sculpt. It's an A and B mix. So there, you get two different jars, and they're 8 ounces piece, so you get a lot of this epoxy sculpt, and it's like a very thick putty paste. Maybe not even, it's more like a thick Play-Doh. And you know, you mix it together much like 5-minute epoxy, except that it's not a liquid, it's a solid already. And you mix it together, you roll it together, and you make little strings with the epoxy sculpt and fit it into the areas. And when you are ready to fit it in, take a brush and use the safety solvent material that you can buy for that, and you can feather it with just a brush and then let it dry, and then you can start sanding.
Yeah, and, you know, if you look in some of the online catalogs, I know that Squadron produces a line of spatulas, different probes and such. You can also find these at the arts and craft stores in the sculpting areas where the modeling clays are. These make great tools for applying and shaping the fillers as you put them on the model. I have a real small, I guess you would call it a palette knife that's used for painting.
Yes.
You know, I have a couple. I have one that is, these are like miniature mortar trowels is what they look like.
Okay.
I have one that's pointed, and it has a very sharp point on the end, and you can hear me flicking it there.
Right.
I can take that point, and I can work putty deep into a crack, and a pretty narrow crack at that. And the one that has a rounded tip on it, that's more for broad coverage areas. And then I make sure that when I'm done with them, that I, you know, wash them off, whether I use a little solvent to get the putty residue off. And even if you let it dry, you can take a nice razor blade and literally just scrape everything right back down to the metal, and then you have a clean tool if you just happen to set it down and forget about it.
Right.
Now, some of the spatulas that you can find that sculptors would use to do, you know, if they're doing a face using the clays to make a face bust or something, those work well. There's just a lot of resources. Popsicle sticks or craft sticks, even old hobby blades. Once they're too dull for using them for cutting plastic, you can take sand them or grind them into different shapes. They're flexible, and nothing really ever sticks to them.
Right. Yeah, I agree with you on all the tools because I use a lot of sculptor tools. I also use a lot of dental tools. The dental tools are very nice for the same reason. They're easy to clean, and you can get into, they're small enough because they're made, of course, to go into somebody's mouth and go into a cavity or whatnot. They're small enough, and they're angled. There's many different angles you can work with to get into those specific areas or those tight areas that you need to fill. So you can use anything. You can use your finger. You can use a toothpick. You can use dental tools. You can use sculpting tools. You can use anything that your heart desires or that you find will work well for you. Again, you know, it's trial and error and progression as a modeler. You find what works best for you, and you may swear by it, and hopefully if you swear by it, you can suggest it to a modeler who's not, you know, as advanced as you are, or maybe as advanced as you are, but looking for an answer, you know, and that's what we're all here for, is answers, you know, and to help each other out.
And a good place to source dental tools is from your dentist.
Yes.
Believe it or not, and I've got most of the tools that I have were either given to me by my dentist or a neighbor who was a dentist. He said, you know, they get to a certain point, they become not suitable for use in the mouth. A lot of times they just throw them in a drawer or in a box somewhere in the office, and eventually they get recycled as metal scrap. But a lot of times, if you ask your dentist, do you have any old probes and such that you would be willing to part with? They may say, here, open the drawer up and take your pick, you know.
Right.
My dentist, he said, I limit people to three at a time, which, you know, hey, you're paying for them.
Right.
That and his new boat, new car, and new house, and his vacation.
Or a model or two.
You might as well get something besides a perfect smile. Get some
right.
modeling tools as well.
Well, you know, let's just say for sake of argument, people can't get to a dentist, or their dentist will say, what are you, crazy? You can pick up a set of dental tools, believe it or not, from Squadron, and you can also pick up dental tools from Micromark. So those are two areas to retailers that you can purchase them from. So
yeah, and you, again, this is another tool that you can source if you don't have a hobby shop that carries them.
Right.
Check your local hardware store. I'm not talking the big box stores. I'm talking your hometown neighborhood hardware stores, because they often have a lot of that stuff available in the tool department. And the price is a lot cheaper than going to a dental supply house to buy it.
Yes.
You'll pay 20-some bucks a piece for a simple probe versus you're going to get it for 99 cents.
The set of dental tools that I have are actually from Squadron, and I picked them up at a Hobby Lobby, which I couldn't believe it. You know, I was at a local Hobby Lobby looking around, and, oh, look, you know, they carry all these tools, which I was really surprised, and they had a blister cart full of 6 dental tools. I'm like, oh, I'm picking those up.
Yeah. Let's just kind of touch on some of the things that we use to shape our fillers. My 3 preferences are I have a set of jeweler's files, different shapes. They're very small. You can pick them up, or another type of file that you can pick up is what they call a riffler file, the stuff that gunsmiths would use, wood carvers use. A lot of them have a curved shape at the end. Like if you got a rat tail, they have a long rat tail with a curve to it, so you can work areas. I like using sanding sticks, whether it be the type you pick up, the big wide flat ones for doing nails. Or I know that a couple companies, Alpha Abrasives, the Touch and Flow people, they produce these real thin cut sanding sticks, which are probably no more than 1/8 to 1/4 inch wide. And they also make they're kind of like a plastic pencil, but it's a plasticized material that's embedded with an abrasive, and they come in different colors for different grits, and those allow you to work in tight confined areas to shape your fillers and such.
Right. Yeah, I agree with all those tools also. I use a lot of smaller tools, a lot of the jeweler files, because of the tight tolerances that I work with like these time machines. This is it's supposed to be a prop reproduction, and the people that ordered these, that you need to build these are going to be under eyes, you know, people are going to be looking at them and whatnot, and I have to make sure that when I'm sanding, I don't have a lot showing, and that I don't I don't want to work with a big area either. You know, I don't want to be sanding for the rest of my life and never get these done for my clients. So I use a lot of dental and jeweler equipment, basically, or tools to get the job done. Now, if I do have a big gap, because sometimes that happens, I'll use my motor tool. I'll use a nice cone-shaped motor tool bit, and I don't have to press hard. I don't have to work at it very hard because the motor tool is doing all the work. And if I need to, I have a box full of motor tool bits that I can change and use depending upon the gap, depending upon the contour of the kit. I have it made with that motor tool. That motor tool, in a way, has saved me a lot of man hours, headaches, and frustration. So I suggest if, you know, you have a motor tool, think of that too as a way that you can sand away. But be forewarned, if you go too much, you can really screw things up. So I would suggest that for the, you know, higher intermediate to advanced modeler to use a motor tool for sanding filler.
Yeah, and that brings up another point, something while you're at the dentist, ask him or her if they have any dental burrs that have become unserviceable. They may not be keen enough to grind away on your teeth, but they may be suitable for working with styrene and shaping fillers. I have a large collection of dental burrs. You can buy them brand new. Just be advised that there are price points on those as well. You can find some very inexpensive ones. They typically are made in countries where metal tools tend to be of low quality, to very expensive ones. Some of the ones I have, I know a little packet of four, you'd probably pay $100 for. But they're very sharp, very precise. They don't wear out all that quickly. I can use them in my motor tool. I have a cordless Dremel. The thing with using anything with mechanical advantages, watch your speed.
Yeah.
Keep your speed down and work with a very light touch.
Yeah.
Which reminds me, let's just cover a couple of the biggest mistakes novices make using fillers. The first and foremost one is they apply it like they're filling a ditch.
Yeah, too much.
They're using a front-end loader, and they're filling a ditch.
Oh, you know, that it's not funny, but I think it's funny because I remember doing that, and looking back on that, I'm like, oh, boy, what was I thinking?
Because you got to remember, what you put in, you're going to end up removing a lot of it.
Yeah.
So the more you put on, the more work it's going to take to get it off, to get it down flush and level with the rest of the contour that you're trying to match. Work in thin, light coats. Just like painting, you want to work in thin, light coats. Gradually build it up. And the other thing that a lot of modelers do is, besides putting it on too thick, they will also, or possibly if they put it on thinly, they don't give it enough time to dry. And when they take that first swipe with the sanding stick or a sandpaper or whatever they're using, it's loaded up.
Right.
You're going to spend 10 minutes just cleaning all the residue, or you're going to go through a sheet of sandpaper, you know, to do a little quarter-inch square patch job on the top of a fuselage.
Well, you know, part of this hobby, no matter what part of it is, no matter what you like, and no matter what, if you're painting, if you're putting something together, if you're parts together, if you're gluing, if you're filling, if you're finishing, you need patience. This is the type of hobby where you need a lot of patience. And, you know, I have that covered in a couple of my videos where, you know, you work on something, okay, you're done with it for now. Put it down, let the glue set, let the filler set up. Walk away from it, work on another part of the model, or just walk away from the model altogether, you know, and let it sit for a couple of days. Make sure that when you're using filler, when you're painting, when you're doing whatever with the model, that you're patient, you take your time, and let things be. Don't rush it, because when you rush things, that's when you screw things up, and that's when things don't go your way. And, you know, it goes with filler. You need to leave the filler alone. Work on another part. Work on another part of the model. Just leave it alone. Leave it alone for 2-3 days. And that's what I do. I'll fill something, and I already kind of have in my head a tally of things that I need to do. I have a list of things I need to do. So I know that I need to fill this in. Okay, I'm going to fill this in. I'm going to let it sit for a week. I'm going to work on something else.
You know, the only exception to that is when you are using CA or super glues as a filler, because the longer it cures, the harder it gets.
Correct. I agree.
And you want to give it the time that it needs to set, but then you need to start shaping it with the appropriate tool quickly, so that it you can get the shaping, the rough shaping done before it turns to steel. You know, what's gonna you know, give away first, the hardest steel CA or the soft styrene plastic? Well, the plastic's gonna lose.
Right.
And you'll end up working harder and doing more filling because you've ground away more plastic than you intended. Now, the other thing modelers especially novices tend to do is they tend to get the filler everywhere, including where they're supposed to fill, but they let it get everywhere else. Either it's on their hands. I like to use masking tape to act as a skirting to confine it and protect any detail on the surface surrounding the area that I'm working.
Yes.
I did a thread over on AeroScale. It's called Reading the Seams, and there's also it's also on the Squawk Box. There's links to it on the Squawk Box, and I'll make sure to include that on this post. But I talk about using different fillers and masking and, you know, working with different tools. Now, we're not limited, as we said, to modeling tools. One of my favorite tools to use for wing roots is actually a large diameter file that's used for doing chainsaw sharpening. It's coarse enough that I can just make one or two passes, and it really works at that wing root where I can get in there and take the filler right off as it just barely touches the plastic. And it works in such a way that if there's, I think the illustration that I gave on that thread was doing the Revell Monogram 148 scale C47, which the fuselage to wing root on the upper side was notoriously known for leaving a gap.
Right. Yeah. There's so many different techniques, and that's the thing with there's many techniques and there's many different products. So, depending upon what you're working on, you're always kind of testing the waters. And you brought up a good point with the CA glue and the kicker. It's the same thing with epoxy. You know, I give it maybe a day. I'll let the epoxy sit for a day. I won't touch it at all. But then in a couple days, you know, I'll get back to it and I'll sand it. All different types of putty has different types of materials that they're made with, and they harden is all different. And a lot of that, you know, it's trial and error. So, you know, that's part of where the patience comes in too. If one putty isn't working, you can try another putty, but you have to make sure that you clean out that area first with that old putty. Make sure it's as clean as you can get it before putting in a different type of filler.
You know, and another thing that I've used in the past, and this sounds kind of weird, but if I've got to do some reinforcing at the same time, what I've done is I've actually used resin. I've mixed up a two-part resin. First, I've created the dam area where I want the resin to go and to contain it and to expand over to the areas that needed filled. And I was able just to mix it up, pour the resin in there, let it set, and then come back and shape that. I've used that technique by taking some metal foil tape on the inside of a fuselage, and I've gone through and done a conversion where I've wanted to relocate a whole fuselage door, and instead of filling that in with styrene, I've actually just said, well, we'll put the tape on the backside. I'll use some putty to create a dam around the existing opening and just put a thin layer of resin in there, let it cure up, and come back, and guess what? I can pull off the modeling clay from around it or the putty that I used to create the dam around the opening, and I can just start sanding and shaping, and it works really well.
That's a very, very good point, and I agree with you using resin sometimes. There are many types of manufacturers for resin. Just like anything else, you have your low-end and you have your high-end. Smooth-On, they're very well known for being a retail level resin supplier. There's Micromark also supplies resin. Much like epoxy, resin, there's different resin setting times. So you have to decide, depending upon where you are in your project, how fast you want to work. Because most of the time, resin will set up quite quickly. There's quick set resin, and then there's resin that'll take a half hour. There's some resin out there that'll take 4 hours to set. So it just depends upon your project and, you know, how fast you want to get done. And much like epoxy and much like super glues, you have to make sure that your area is clean, and you have to make sure that you have a game plan. And that's very important with these fillers. It doesn't matter what type of filler you're using. It doesn't matter if it's for resin, styrene plastic, vinyl, whatnot, wood. Have a game plan. Try to think ahead. Try to be two steps ahead so you know where you're going and know where you want to end up being with that particular area.
Well, that's true. And I see by Chippy's running across here, across the studio console, to remind me that, you know, it's trick-or-treat night. It's Halloween. And the little goblins are starting to make their way around the neighborhood. And I know you need to go trick-or-treating with your little goblins.
Yes, I do. I have four of them that are waiting. And I still have to get dressed myself. I know my wife is waiting for me. And, yes, we're planning on having a good time trick-or-treating around the neighborhood.
All right. Well, Jason, thanks for being on the show. Look forward to having you on again. And enjoy the evening's activities, and don't eat too much candy, okay? We wouldn't want you getting sick.
I will try not to eat too much, and it would be a pleasure to be on again. Thank you for having me.
All right. We'll talk to you soon.
Okay. Take care.
My thanks to our sponsors and supporters, but most of all, thank you for being a listener. Fellow scale modeling enthusiasts, remember, it's not the workbench that makes the model. It is the modeler at the workbench. This is Hawkeye. I hope you can tune in next week. Until then, happy modeling.